So, yeah, definitely more people showing up than when I complained about it the first time. It's always a bad idea. It's just something that makes no sense. I have to stop myself from doing it. Complaining about people not showing up to all the people who showed up. I get it. Move on. Yeah, they're not here. What are we talking about? I suspect that one of the reasons why it turned out a little bit thin is because there was a really big assignment that was due 2 minutes ago for you guys. So there's some people who are probably sleeping off a very long night right now. How did it go for you? What did you think of the assignment? What did you think it was? A good writing assignment to write?
Vegas.
All you're going to get back from me directly is, yeah, you did it. You completed the assignment. That's what you're going to get back from me directly. What you'll get indirectly, possibly directly, and you can always feel free to volunteer this. As often as I can, and this is kind of like time and schedule for me, and I'm going to, this is a habit I'm trying to be better about for myself this semester. I'll take these drafts and I'll just pick one, maybe two, and I'll do like a screen capture video of me kind of reading through it and talking about, hey, this is what it does well. This is what it maybe needs to work on. And if you're thinking to yourself, like, I do not want to volunteer for that, know that I'm very charitable and cognizant of the fact that this is a draft. I told you that it was a draft. For a lot of you, it's like, oh, that's a drafty draft. There are, like, holes all over it. Mostly what I want to get is some sense of, like, what is it that we should be shooting for? What should we be, like, trying to do with these drafts in order to get them in shape for a final reflection session? And one of those is coming up just before spring break, so it's never too early to think about that. When is spring break? March 11th-ish, I think. Yeah, somewhere around there. Yes, there's a philosophy club. I don't know if you guys are aware of it. There's also a fascinating lecture today at 2 p.m. on John Locke's theory of property, which you might be thinking to yourself, wait a minute, that's right now. Yeah, that's unfortunate. Because there was a possibility there for a little while that he wasn't going to make it by 2 and that it would happen in 5 instead. So I was like, oh, wait a minute, now I'm not going to get to go. What's that? Oh, yeah, mixing the labor with the land. So yeah, we're going to get it. When we read John Locke's First Treatise on Government, we'll talk about property. What a bizarre concept property is. But before we get to all of that stuff, writing. It's a thing, right? It's a tool that you can use in order to think and communicate with people. But it doesn't necessarily come naturally to everyone, right? There's something about this kind of, sometimes it's referred to as a republic of letters, that's springing up throughout the early Enlightenment and early modernity. We're kind of like watching an handful, right? We have Descartes writing his meditations, inviting commentary, inviting objections and replies, corresponding with all sorts of people all over Europe. Almost said all over the world, definitely not. All over Europe. We have some French guy. We have some Czech princess who's now living in the Netherlands. Now we have an English woman in the mix who are all kind of communicating with one another, reading what everybody else is writing. We don't really do letter writing. Have I asked you guys about that? Like, when was the last time you wrote a letter? Is there anybody here who's never written a letter to somebody? And we might wonder, like, does an email count? Like, isn't an email a letter?
It's a different medium.
You've never
written
a letter.
Medium?
It's not.
You literally
what's
designed
different?
A letter.
What's different about writing a letter to somebody than sending them an email?
It's more.
Isn't it the weight? That weight might be really important, by the way, too, right? That weight gives you time to, like, think and digest. The slowness of letter writing is maybe particularly well-suited to the slowness of philosophy. You guys notice that philosophy, the way that philosophy thinks is incredibly slow. Little tiny steps, one at a time. Slower than most people can appreciate. In fact, that, you know, oftentimes that's one of my biggest criticisms of student writing. Slow down, you're jumping from like premise to conclusion. But slow down, show me all the steps in between. Show me that your thinking is careful. So that's nice. That's a nice way to kind of slow down your thought. It's a write. It's a nice way to have a conversation with yourself. too. It's to write. You put it down on paper, you come back the next day and you look at it and you're like, what idiot wrote this crap? That's, yeah. Do you guys have that experience? Yeah. When you look at your old writing, you're just like, who was the stupid person that took over my mind and like wrote this?
Yep.
Which is nice. That means you're coming at it like with fresh eyes. You make adjustments, make revisions. Good writing is rewriting, blah, blah, blah.
Or you tear it apart and see your name.
Yeah. Yes?
So there will be no feedback really on these graphs.
There will be indirect feedback. There will be feedback to at least one that everybody gets to see. And everybody else is going to say, like, yep, you did it. And even the one that I give feedback to, I'm going to say, yep, you did it. By the way, here's other, like, if this was a final draft, here are the things that I would say. So, yeah, like I said, feel free to volunteer for that, and that goes for people in the online section, too. People in the online section had a discussion board about this before they had to write it, that some of them made some good use of. We had discussions in class, not so much a discussion board. Where did you guys come down on this question? Because it was kind of, it seemed like it was more or less of a binary choice, although there's always this option that you can, your response to my prompt. If my prompt looks like it's forcing a dilemma, you can always say like, ooh, false dilemma. I don't want to play by that rule. It's actually not, it's not this or this, it's some other thing. You can always try to challenge the question. That's like expert level version of the assignment. I wouldn't recommend trying that unless you really feel strong. Yeah, where did you guys come down? Does he pull it off? Does he hold to a standard?
I'd say it's impossible.
Yeah. Let's see a show of hands.
So, in my draft, I didn't really quite get around to it, and I still had trouble like interpreting what he's trying to say in his meditations, but I was trying to refer back to the third meditation that talks about objective reality. And
he said, like, he was doing fine until that third meditation when he started this kind of bizarre talk about two different kinds of reality and how they relate to one another. And that's where he trips up. Okay. Yeah, that's interesting. Does anybody else kind of feel a little bit, kind of express a little bit of doubt? Like, I wasn't certain of myself proceeding through this assignment because I wasn't certain of what Descartes was actually saying. So this is at least one, let's identify this as one crucial part of doing this assignment well. You should probably represent Descartes' views fairly accurately. Accurately? In a plausible way, right? There are like many, many ways to read Descartes. I don't know if I'm giving you guys this impression as I'm doing the exposition of this material, but like...
You're being charitable.
Yeah, and not always just being charitable. Sometimes I'm saying like there are multiple ways to read this. I'm not really sure how we should read it. Usually our rule is read it in a way that makes it the most plausible. But even then, you can be a little uncertain. So there's a little bit of wiggle room, but it's not anything goes, right? If you say to yourself, if you're like writing like Descartes says that there's only matter and nothing else, you'd be like, whoa, no. He doesn't say that at all. Okay. What other characteristics do you think of like a very good version of this assignment you have to have? Garrett, you had something else?
Something that is part of the rubric and part of any good, I think, present an argument is anticipation of counter-arguments and, like, reacting to those counter-arguments almost as before they can be presented, since obviously you won't be there, like, to respond to them.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And in fact, let me even back you up a little bit before we even get to that. In addition to your argument, you should be considering and trying to anticipate a counter-argument. But you should have an argument. Maybe that's the first part, too. Like, and maybe we can even back it up before that. You should have a position. Don't just tell me like what Descartes said. I mean, frequently I will get folks to turn in assignments where I ask a question like this. Does Descartes hold to his epistemic standard throughout the entirety of the meditations? And they say, this is what Descartes says. Blah, 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 blah. Well, yeah, he does say that. But that doesn't really answer the question. Take a position on the question. Defend it. And anticipate possible counter-arguments. Defend against those. This starts to get really, really big. Maybe you can figure it out. Some of you found that like the word length target was maybe a little bit restrictive.
Yeah.
You feel like you gotta go, oh, that's good. I'd like you guys to feel, I'd rather you feel constrained by the word limit than kind of feel it scrambling to try to get to it. Use that. Use that as a little mechanism to try to make your writing and your thought cleaner, more precise, more focused. It should be like a 3-minute punk song. absolutely need to be there. And sometimes that's a really, really difficult, that's an emotionally difficult thing to do. I find myself sometimes, I like, wrote a very nice paragraph, and I'm like, I like the way I said that, and then I look back and I'm like, that doesn't really belong in this paper. But I want people to read it, so I guess it stays on the paper, right? Now you gotta kill your darlings. But, oh, before, you don't have to kill your darlings, by the way. I like to keep a separate file on my desktop. It's all like these little orphans. Like, I don't know where they go. It's a good idea, but it didn't belong in any paper.
I got at this question when preaching it. Because we're citing PDF formats, and like that, do we just cite the text as a whole? Like, can we say Descartes' The Meditations as?
It's nice if you can direct me to which of the six.
Okay.
That helps. That's fine. Yeah, and I'm not even picky about the style, although, I don't know, like, sometimes I get the impression from students that they'd like it if I was pickier about the style, and just told them, like, hey, it's another, oh, it's Chicago, like, just do that. But as long as it's an intelligible citation, if you say to me, like, in Meditation 2, Descartes says, blah, 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 that was enough, right there. You don't need a parenthetical citation on top of that. Any other questions about this? About writing styles in general? And think about, like, I'm kind of posing this as posing these prompts as like getting you to write in an essay style, and for a lot of us that's how we've been trained to write, but you can tell there are other ways to write, right? 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 You can write it as a letter to somebody. You can write it as a dialogue, although that's also like that's some masterclass shit. Like don't go messing around trying to write a dialogue until you're feeling really comfortable. I used to ask people to write dialogues in ancient class. You can write it as a letter. You can write it as a faux letter. That's what Margaret Cavendish is doing, right? They're not real letters to people. It's kind of like this weird hybrid between a letter and a diary entry, right? Yeah. She's writing as if she's writing to somebody else, you and Adam. They're going to be talking about Margaret Cavendish's philosophical letters. But like very different circumstances. Miss Elizabeth, obviously a princess, was up in all of the kind of affordances of like the best possible education anybody could possibly have at that time. She has tutors, she has access, she like speaks all kinds of different languages, she has access to primary source texts. She's writing letters to Descartes, and Descartes is writing back, maybe a little dismissively from time to time, but still writing. Margaret Cavendish complains at least that like she wasn't really well educated. Mother never really saw to it that she was properly educated. Possibly because her mother wasn't all that well educated herself. Yet she manages to kind of like get into this conversation somehow. How is it that she does manage to get into this conversation?
She had someone translate.
She had somebody translate the Meditations for her. Yeah, she can't read it in the, she doesn't read Latin, she doesn't read French, so she can't read it directly. She has sections translated for her. And I gotta say that like one of the things that is difficult about reading her philosophical letters is that she refers to Descartes by name periodically. She refers to the author frequently, and you're not sure, like, is that Descartes? Because sometimes when she says, the author says X, Y, Z, you're kind of like, I don't remember Descartes saying it quite like that. And sometimes she's talking about like the author, and it's clear, like that, oh, that's definitely Descartes. So yeah, it's not clear, like, is she responding to multiple authors? Is it always Descartes? But she's, I don't know, we can say that she's a reliable reader of Descartes. We have to imagine some version of Descartes that she's arguing against. So all of this makes it kind of difficult. Why isn't she writing directly to Descartes?
Well,
because it's dead. Yeah. But aside from that, why is she writing to herself and not anybody else? Does she have access to, she's a duchess, by the way. She's not a princess. She's the Duchess of Newcastle on time. And her husband, William Cavendish, he knows all the big brains at the time. I was talking about a republic of letters, this kind of international sort of community of thinkers and people who are talking to one another about these things while war rages on all across Europe and in England as well. We're talking just a second that Margaret Cavendish's story goes right through the English Civil War, and it's a really big deal. It's a big part of what's going on. Her husband knows all sorts of those. We're talking about, he knew Descartes and corresponded with Descartes before Descartes died. Mersenne, Gassendi is a who's who of modern thinkers. Thomas Hobbes, the Cavendishes are very good friends with Thomas Hobbes, and you can see, if we know anything about Thomas Hobbes' take on these sorts of matters, we're not reading him in this part portion of the class, but we'll see a little bit of flashes of it in the second half when we read Leviathan. There are big influences on Cavendish, either from Hobbes, or they're both kind of swimming in the same water. They're both kind of articulating the same sorts of ideas. An idea that's sort of crystallizing in Britain during this time, an idea about empiricism. Yes? He helped her publish it. Yeah, right. She did get out there, yeah. She would write these things for herself, yeah. And then her husband he encouraged her to write. That's a nice thing to do. Encourage people to write. Hey, I'll do it for you guys. I encourage you to write by giving you assignments periodically. I don't know if I'll publish everything that you write. But yeah, William Cavendish starts publishing Duchess Cavendish's work. And so yeah, that's something. It's not like she's on the outside of this conversation. But it is clear that while her husband has direct access to these folks, she's got kind of almost an indirect access. It's always through her husband. Yeah. That's right, yeah. Yeah, so this is part of it, the historicity of where Margaret Cavendish is kind of coming into this. This is shaping the way that she's engaging with the conversation. And she's still doing it, right? It doesn't stop her from engaging it. It maybe puts some filters, gives us some things to think about when we're reading her. But she's still getting involved. And it's not just, by the way, it's not just Descartes, Mersenne, Gassendi, Hobbes, people who are typically thought of as philosophers. It's also people who are typically thought of as scientists now. Robert Boyle is good friends with the Cavendishes. If you remember your basic chemistry, Boyle's Law?
Yeah.
That's Robert Boyle. And, who else? Christian Huygens, Mr. Wave Theory, Dutch guy. All over here, I'm saying, national borders mean nothing. There's this community of thinkers that are all in touch with one another. And through her husband, Margaret Cavendish has access to all these folks as well. Yes?
I got the sense when reading, and one of the things that struck me as she talks about inanimate matter and animate matter and the difficulties of how they can interact and what they can cause, there might be the things would be a lot clearer if they had a concept of the laws of energy transfer, don't seem to entirely understand. I feel like some of your problems would be solved if you had
a thing called energy.
Yeah.
You might be able to handle it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a good read. Shall we dive right into what she's up to?
Yeah.
Try to see if we can piece it together. No more preamble about that. You don't want to hear about the English Civil War or anything like that.
If you want to.
No, I don't really care. I'm not a historian. I try to do that a little flavor. But if we want to jump right into arguments, we totally can. I'll say one little thing. This is a very different sort of a conflict than what's going on the continent at the time. That's kind of, we talked about shaping Princess Elisabeth's life. It's very different than the 30 Years' War. This is a civil war. This is internal. The tension is between Parliament and the King. And this is the sort of thing that I'll just kind of point to as we pass by it right now, because this is the big starting point for the political component of the class. This shift in attention from how are we going to use our consolidated force of all of us kind of coming together, bless you, and granting some kind of authority to some sort of governmental figure, to a king or something like this, is no longer thinking about like the relationship with outside groups, but now it's thinking about this kind of like internal relationship and whether or not it can be challenged from within. That's the beginning of the whole political revolution that happens in the world. So that's I point to it as it goes by and say, like, we'll come back and we'll read Thomas Hobbes and we'll be talking about the English Civil War as well. Margaret Cavendish and William Cavendish both met in France while both of them were exiled from England because they supported Charles I, who ended up having his head removed. And so she is a lady in waiting for royalty who flees to France. William Cavendish was also a supporter of Charles I. He's in France. They meet each other. She starts meeting all these other people, all these famous philosopher types. And that's kind of what... That was it for her. Her life was nothing the same. She was a philosopher. You know?
How did they get their Cartesian?
How was that?
How did they get a Cartesian if they were exiled in France?
How do we get what now?
How did they get back? Like, in
oh, because then there's a restoration. And there's a whole, like, Oliver Cromwell holds on for a little while, but then the king gets brought in. It's a revolution that doesn't hold.
Oh, yeah. Well.
And that's the history of the English Civil War, which is only marginally less complicated than the 30 years before. Everybody, a little sicky today. All right, so Margaret Cavendish, I think one of the things that it helps to have some focusing tools when reading her to try to get some sense of where she's coming from, because an awful lot of what she's talking about is a little bit unclear. Maybe this is a function, by the way, of writing by yourself and not having an actual dialogue back and forth with somebody, is that there isn't anybody to kind of call you out like Princess Elisabeth does for Descartes that says, like, that doesn't make any sense. I don't know about you guys. I find that out about my writing all the time. It made perfect sense in my head when I was just running through the idea really, really fast. Then I tried to explain it to somebody, or I tried to write it all down, and I was like, oh, more complicated than I thought. So one of these focusing ideas is this idea that Margaret Cavendish, and she's not alone in this, but she's definitely kind of marking at this shift that begins with Descartes and then kind of like turns away from dualism and comes right into this British empiricist moment, this idea of approaching specifically the mind, from a kind of a natural philosophy perspective. We might say a scientific perspective, but it's not really science yet. It's proto-science, proto-scientific perspective. I might even say just it's an empiricist perspective. All of these tools that we use to study nature, why don't we use those to study the human mind? Why shouldn't they be the same tools? And this is one of the things that we'll get to this by the end. Margaret Cavendish is talking very clearly about this idea. She's quite clear that some of the errors that she sees Descartes or her version of Descartes and other people making about these questions is that they somehow suppose that humans, the human mind in particular, is outside of nature. And that's a convenient thing to believe, I suppose, if you want to think you're special.
Very anthropocentric.
Well, however we think about ourselves, it's probably going to be anthropocentric, I suppose. But yeah, maybe that it's chauvinistic might be the word that we might think. That we think like our kind is somehow better than other kinds. Yeah. Animals become like a thing, and we know how Descartes feels about animals, so we'll get to that just a little bit. But a big part of this like is right at the beginning as well. If we kind of understand that this is a crucial aspect of the approach that she's articulating, and we can find it in Hobbes as well, as I mentioned, is this idea that humans are natural. The human mind is a natural thing. When we start thinking about how nature works, well, one of the things that's starting to kind of coalesce out of early modernity right now as proto-science starts to step into real science is this idea that nature follows laws, I guess. It's predictable. It has patterns. And if you study them, you can figure out how those patterns work. And if mind is the same way, then we can study mind with a set of scientific tools. Now, what would that look like? Especially if we don't have all of like the furniture and everything that we do have now when we think about scientific tools. For example, if energy is not a thing in this day, what's it going to look like? Margaret Cavendish gives us a pretty good idea of what it's going to look like. questions, and we will ask questions, I'm sure. If she had energy, will this all make sense? Or is it still like a little bit of a weird problem? So she starts out talking about, there's a whole like cluster of concepts, and they all seem to be kind of roiling around the same set of questions. She wants to talk about, she talks about motion for a little while. She talks about place for a little while. She's talking about causation. And it's not even clear that she's talking about, I set this up by saying we're approaching mind from this perspective. It's not even clear that she's talking about mind just yet. She's just talking in general about things like motion and place and causation. And one of the things that she's saying about motion, and this is a place where, I don't know about you guys, I find myself wondering how she's reading Descartes, because I don't necessarily recognize this. But she's saying, Descartes says that motion is this thing that's separate from material substance, that it's a mere mode of material substance. And seems to think that this somehow means that motion is separable from material substance, and she's saying, like, no, no. Motion requires bodies. You can't have motion without bodies. We said the same thing about place. You can't have place without bodies. If something has a place, it's a body. It's a material body. And actually, one of the reasons why like I find this kind of difficult to swallow as a reading of Descartes was I remember Descartes, or at least I remember my reading of Descartes. Maybe this isn't in Descartes. Maybe this is Rosenfeld art. That's a terrible version of that. Maybe it's my version of Descartes. I mean, that's not elegant either. But Either way, I seem to remember like reiterating this idea that like mind doesn't have aware. And it seems like Descartes is pretty comfortable with that idea that mind doesn't have aware. How do you feel about this idea that mind doesn't have aware? If I ask you, where are you? Here? Is it always that? Here, right? I'm here. Wherever you go, you're here. Do you move? If you get up and, like, walk, did you just move?
I would argue that I have two places.
Two places. Oh. This makes you divisible with respect to place?
I mean, I would argue that there's always where you are corporally, or perhaps to channel the current, where you might like be able to will yourself to be, and then there is also where you are from an intellectual perspective.
Now, is that a metaphorical where, or is it a literal where?
Which one?
The second one, the where you are from an intellectual perspective. Because we can say the same thing about motion, too. Like, do you, like, your body moves, but I don't know, does your mind move? Your thoughts move, at least, right? Go from one thought to another. There's a progression in thought when you think. Thinking is a kind of a motion of thought, right? If your thought is standing still, I don't know if I would call that thinking. Thinking means to be a little more active.
Suppose the question becomes like, does the dwelling upon of things by your conscious self necessitate that you have, that you are in a different place, or merely that that occurred in the same place as your body?
Ah, yeah, so when you daydream, and somebody says, where are you right now? As if to suggest that there could be some other answer rather than here. We might also wonder, like, how metaphorical is this when we talk about the where of ourselves? My sense is that Margaret Cavendish takes it as just kind of like patently obvious. That you have a where, that you are capable of moving, and that you have place. For all of us, if we wanted to make it really simple, for all of us, like, our place is always right here. That's the easiest way to describe it.
Doesn't she say that place can never change?
That's one of the ways of trying to read, like, what does she mean when she says place never change? Place for, like, a body never changes, and that's to say it's always here. For your body, at least, you're always right here. Yes?
I think, to some extent, it would have been easier if she kind of defined what she meant by place. I thought sometimes she kind of almost was gaining volume or shape or the necessary existence of an object.
She does talk about shape in a distinct way later on, when she's talking about like falling into the snow and you leave your shape behind. So she's got a pretty clear idea that shape is something different. But yeah, you're right, it is a little bit ambiguous.
Yeah, like, because if you think how I've always conceived it, and I might be completely wrong, is that, you know, in a 3D axis, if my arm is right here and now the pen is right here,
site, right? It's not. It's not a. Your location is not a single.
So
this is not a single dimensionless point in space.
Does she mean location by place?
So this is one of the, like, she could have said location in space, I suppose.
Yeah.
This is also getting into territory that, like, Margaret Cavendish is not working it out, but, like, she can hardly be blamed. Nobody's really working out just yet, but it is right on the horizon. People are going to start talking about space and what the hell space is, and what the heck location in space would be, and we'll ask questions about, is that even the same thing as place? Are place and location in space exactly the same? I know we have a tendency to think about them as collapsed, but I don't know that here. Here certainly seems to be a place. I don't know if here is a location in space.
Probably several.
Could be both? Yeah. They're close, but not quite exactly the same concept. So, like, you might be careful with that as well. Yes, Ron?
I think Margaret is right in the sense that, like, you know, as we kind of intuitively think of where we are, it's local, you know, where our bodies are. And you guys are saying this complicated stuff of, like, you know, Descartes, obviously, you know, is where is the mind existing? You kind of avoid all that trouble and weird stuff if you just go back to the form and matter composite that Aristotle set up. You have this, actually, you account for the, you know, non-physical and the physical, and you have them. You can't have it separated at
and
that
form
point.
Isn't like a separate thing that's a different substance.
Yes, it's not.
That substance
off.
Is only form and matter together. Prime matter itself also not substance just yet. It doesn't be. It doesn't exist as a thing. You have that matter plus form together. Yeah, that's the Aristotelian perspective on it. Like I kind of like it too.
I think it escapes.
Like,
this is a problem.
Yeah. Exactly. The exposition of the course is that we move forward from here, not backwards to Aristotle. But yeah, for sure. Like,
one,
if you'd like to read Aristotle, I'm all for it.
The point of arguing is, can you break down the Aristotelian argument? Because I didn't quite follow.
The Aristotelian position on this is that form and matter, and notice this is a little bit different than mind and body, right? This is maybe one of the differences, is that the Aristotelian framework is thinking about this in terms of form and matter. This is a distinction that they're inheriting from Plato, and Plato, in turn, is probably inheriting it from the Pythagoreans.
Plato and Aristotle are very different.
They're both identifying a distinction between matter and form.
Okay.
This is the framework that we're trying to wrestle with. So Plato has one sort of take on it, Aristotle has a different one, and the take that he has is that matter itself is not substance, form itself is not substance. The only thing that's substance, the only thing that exists, is a combination of matter and form. For most things, even Aristotle says, like, numbers are weird, I don't know what to do with those. God is weird, I don't know what to do with that either. The rational part of the mind, I'm really not sure what to do with that either. But he's working through that sort of framework. Descartes kind of messes things up a little bit by sliding into this substance dualist thing where now we're thinking in terms of bodies and minds. And he's talking about a composite, the body-mind unity, and it's correspondence with Princess Elisabeth, but even that seems to be confusing, right? And now we have Margaret Cavendish. You know, all the way from Aristotle back to Margaret Cavendish in what, like 2.5 minutes? Motion and place, she's identifying that both of these properly belong to bodies. And can't be separated. And she's even talking about, like, what would that look like if motion were a separable thing? Or if place were a separable thing from a body, that the body could move on but leave the place behind? What would that be like? And maybe some of us are like, I don't think it's so complicated about that. It's a point in space. But now you've got to think about, like, space as a thing, right? That has locations, spatial locations on space.
Relative.
That's weird, yeah, and this seems a little, this relative relationship seems more like place than location and space. So this is, we see, like, this whole business of, like, what exactly place is and what space is confusing. It's a hard metaphysical problem, and I don't know that Margaret Cavendish is solving it exactly, but she's pointing out that, like, it gets even weirder if you think that motion and place are separable from the bodies that are in motion and have places. And furthermore, we can make this point that I was making earlier, that it seems obvious that we ourselves move and have place. And if this is stuff that properly belongs to bodies. This means that we are bodies. We're not some immaterial soul that doesn't have any place, that can't possibly be. We would have to be material.
Does this mean that we are not thinking things insofar as...
Oh, we're still thinking things. Because this would be the obvious Cartesian rejoinder, right? It's like, but I'm a thinking thing. And then Cavendish is going to have to come back and say, what, you're not a thinking thing? No, she'll say, yeah, you're right, you're a thinking thing, I'm a thinking thing, and we're material. This has to mean that matter thinks.
So she's doing away with Descartes'
dualism
on the soul?
Mm-hmm. Now, it's not clear that she's an out-and-out substance monist, a materialist. She's a materialist about the soul, right, or the mind. She's a materialist about the thinking subject. She's a materialist about ourselves. She leaves the door open. I think it's in her philosophical, in the selections that we had. She leaves the door open for God, I think, at one point. She's like, maybe God is material. She's not completely banishing the whole concept of the material substance. She's just saying it doesn't make sense to talk about ourselves. We would have to be outside of nature in order to talk about it that way. Yeah, that's where she's going to end up saying it's like, and animals think as well. And, you know, probably like back falling back into an Aristotelian model on soul. Probably plants too. Maybe even going farther. Maybe a rock.
But does she redefine thought in saying that those things think?
Oh, we'll get to that. Yeah, eventually. You guys are asking the right questions. Let's slow down one step at a time. Oh, by the way, if we ourselves are material and have like motion in place and all of the things that bodies have, then we can use the same tools that we use to study bodies to study ourselves, right? And we're back to this idea of like an empirical kind of like scientific sort of, there's not a discipline called psychology at this point, but what she's trying to do here is something like psychology. Treat the mind the same as any other natural phenomenon. Study it in an organized scientific way. And that's what we're going to get. Now, she doesn't have a whole lot of conceptual or experimental tools, so the way that she's approaching it still looks distinctly philosophical. This is what I mean when I say philosophy and science haven't really quite disentangled one another, themselves from one another yet. It's not clear that they ever really do. We at least operate in different departments of the university now. My guess is that if you took a physics class and you took a philosophy class, you'd expect to get very different sorts of experiences. But certainly at this point, there isn't really much of a difference. People are not making a distinction.
Could that be because maybe at the time a lot of concepts about science are still unknown?
And we're still looking to ground science, right? There's an awful lot of kind of incipient philosophy of science being done. It's not a discipline. There are not people saying, we're doing philosophy of science, because there people would be like, philosophy of what now? It's this science thing. But they're trying to ground. They're trying to offer some kind of justification for why science is a good way to try to understand the world, or why what we call science today. A good way to understand the world. Thinking about the world in terms of matter, following certain sorts of predictable rules, acting in a sort of mechanized way. Now, none of this is really new. We can trace this back to books like Democritus and Leucippus back in the ancient era, this sort of like atomistic approach. And we'll get it like in some kind of later Hellenistic thinking as well. But she's putting a very interesting and distinctly modern spin on this, and especially as she's responding to Descartes, you see that there's something really weird and interesting going on. All of this stuff that she's saying in her conversation about motion and place, which is, I grant you, very confusing and hard to follow, kind of bleeds nicely into a discussion of causation where she's talking the same sort of way about how, like, shape, for example, seems to be another thing that, like, it properly belongs to material bodies. It's not this thing that you can kind of abstract it away. We need to think of a way of maybe talking about how causation happens and like one thing bumps into another and causes it to move. This is a question that we're going to have about motion. How does that happen? And one way of talking about it is to say motion is a separate thing and it gets transferred from the one thing into the other thing. She says, that's going to be kind of weird though, right?
Okay,
the
energy.
Yeah. Because, for example, you would like if you kept bouncing things into a billiard ball and it kept moving, You would expect, like, what? That, like, it's getting heavier because it's got more movement in it now? Is there more stuff? Is it more real because it's going faster? And it's just like, no, that's not real. And this is exactly right. This is where, like, an idea of energy would be really, really helpful. You could talk about energy being transmitted. And you could even say something like, it's not even a separate substance, which nobody will know until the beginning of the 20th century, but it's also exchangeable with matter, right? Matter and energy are just kind of two sides of the same coin.
Looking it up, like, Isaac Newton is around 20 years old at this point.
That's right. So is, yeah, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz.
So, just about to start making those assertions.
That's right. We're right on the doorstep
of,
like, the dam breaking with respect to modern scientists. You know? Yeah, and it's Newton in Britain, and it's Leibniz over in Germany. We end up saying some very similar stuff to, like, Margaret Cavendish as well. Sadly, we're not reading. This is one possible route through this material. It would be like from Cavendish off to Leibniz and then Spinoza. And really fascinating stuff. We're taking a slightly different route. We're going to Locke, Hume, Kant.
Okay, so I've got a question. I wonder how you think that Margaret Cavendish would respond to it. So in regards to space, is space something that just is and bodies move early, or is it something that expands over bodies as bodies?
So, I don't know exactly how she would answer it, but I would imagine she might ask you, if she was going to take a Socratic tack,
right. She'd
do it something like this. Is space part of nature?
I would say so. I would say so.
Yeah, it's not like outside of the natural world, right?
Right.
So, does that mean, is space some kind of like immaterial substance? It has extension.
Right. I mean,
there are locations in space.
Plasma is.
Yeah. Is space matter?
Yeah.
I don't even know if dark matter is space. Nobody knows what dark matter means. It's a scientist word, like, I don't know what the hell that is.
There must be something. How familiar are you with quantum fluctuation?
Well, I find that this is one of those topics where, like, the more somebody says that they're familiar, usually that means the less familiar.
Like, I'm not claiming to be...
I'm familiar enough with it to know that, well, I'll say, like, I have a bachelor's of science in chemistry, and so, like, I know something about this stuff, I had to learn it, and on top of that, I know enough about it to know that, like, I don't have, like, any idea what the hell's coming.
But that's sufficient to, you know that they seem to be suggesting that, you know, there is this thing, you know, space vacuum energy, or different names for it, but...
But it's referred to as an energy, right?
Yes, energy. But there has to be, like, it's a something. I mean, I don't know that it's...
Space is a something.
No, but I'm saying there's something occupying that space.
Oh,
something of
something
some nature. I don't know what...
But is space a something? Or is space... Is space nothing?
Yes.
And things are in it.
Yeah, space with things.
And keep in mind, if you just said that space is nothing,
I don't know.
Then, like, I don't know why are we talking about it if it's nothing. We've got like problems with the void now, right? A nothingness that is something.
What was the original question?
Yeah, I don't remember. We were supposedly there's space under causation. That I think. I was talking about things moving and how energy could be useful.
Yes.
I'm talking about place. And also shape seems to be a sort of thing that, like, properly belongs to material bodies. You can't separate shape from a body in this way that now you have a bodiless shape and a shapeless body. Like, no, this is Aristotle 101, right? They both have to go together. So what's going on then when, for example, you fall down in the snow and you make a snow angel and you get up? Did you leave your shape behind?
It's a private.
You left an impression behind? You, like, and she does this with a wax seal as well. You take a seal ring, you push it into like warm, soft wax, and it leaves the impression behind. But the seal still has its shape, right? It didn't like leave part of its shape behind. So what's going on? To think about these things as abstractable and that are getting like kind of traded back and forth from one physical body to the other, as if they're separable from physical bodies. Just seems to be absurd as far as Margaret Cavendish is concerned, or as far as my reading of Margaret Cavendish is concerned. And that seems to make sense to me at least a little bit too. We've got you've got this other thing called energy that would be like, oh yeah, maybe that might work, and by the way, it wouldn't be a separate substance. If that's what Margaret Cavendish is worried about, that like it would be a separate substance, we'd say like, ah, it's really just matter at the end of the day anyway. Mm-hmm. How would I talk about this? With the snow angel thing. Imposing one body imposing a shape on another body?
Is that obtaining a shape, though, since it's a privation?
Because it's the negative space. But it still takes a shape, right?
Right.
It's the inverted shape. It's the negative version of the shape.
I guess how she would describe it.
Snow is the shape, not the...
And that's only one version of this, by the way, but I don't know if anybody else is noticing that like we've got this continuum that's kind of starting to suggest itself, that's going from the way like a billiard ball bounces into another billiard ball and transfers motion and location and space when two things collide with one another gets changed, and also the way that like shape can be transmitted when two bodies interact with one another. And we might even start to talk about things like, I don't know. When you talk to me, you move an idea from your mind into my mind.
That's weird.
That these are all ways that, like, things are interacting with one another. And if we think that this is all within nature, and if we think that it's true that, like, minds, billiard balls, dogs, birds, trees, snow, microwave ovens, like, all of this stuff, it's all just matter. There's no immaterial substance in that mix. Maybe there's God, but like that's a whole different conversation. And we're going to study it all as if it's matter, right? It's all going to be like the same sort of processes that we're thinking of, whether it's the translation of motion, maybe the translation of shape or form, the translation of an idea from one mind to another. It seems like it's all going to work more or less the same way, and the riddle that we have before us here, that I don't know if I go so far as to say that Cavendish solves it, is to say, yeah, how does that happen? Like, what would minds look like if we thought about them working in this way? Yes? Body changes the shape of the snow. It doesn't change it arbitrarily, right? It changes it into the same shape as the body.
Correct. Right.
Yeah. So it changes it into. It's almost like it's duplicating. It's like it leaves the shape behind and carries it with it when it leaves. But a negative version of it. Yeah. Which is like some of you might be thinking to yourself like Rosenfeld and Cavendish, like you guys are mystifying this way more than it needs to be done. And I'll grant you that these aren't like very provocative philosophical mysteries when we're thinking about them. Motion and pace and causation. That's not the sort of stuff that's going to keep me up like really, really late at night. But once she starts articulating a continuum or a continuity of like the way of thinking about these to thinking about the way that ideas get changed from one mind to another, the way that that mental causation occurs, suddenly now I'm all ears and I'm thinking to myself like, I was distinctly unimpressed with Cartesian dualism. Princess Elisabeth convinced me of this. One of the problems that gets mentioned under causation is the interaction problem. Cavendish brings it up all on her own. And it's not clear if she knows that about the correspondence between Princess Elisabeth and her. So she kind of independently comes to this interaction problem as well. This question of if minds weren't immaterial, how on earth would they cause any sorts of effects in matter and vice versa? That's way simpler to just think of it all as matter. And now we just have a puzzle of how to think about mental causation as essentially the same sort of thing as material causation. And maybe it's not an insoluble puzzle. We have this interaction problem, we have these sorts of problems. What else we have? One more thing. I saw a hand up.
It seems we're framing this wrong with the cause and effect, because in the way that we're thinking it's giving the effect something. I hate to keep jumping back to him, but Aristotle suggests...
he's a smart guy,
what can I say?
Yeah.
The effect or a new state or whatever, what have you, already exists within the object in potency. It's just actualized by an object in act.
Yeah, that ends up being kind of not the clearest of ideas either, because that means that like you're carrying around all these potencies, right?
And what is a potency is not a thing in itself apart from a relation to something, an act, though.
It's a way of being, though, right? This is maybe an office hours conversation.
What do you mean by a way of being?
Well, I mean, like, if we're all things of Aristotle, Aristotle says many, on many occasions, that being is said in many ways, and potentiality, dunamis, is like one of the ways of saying being. I can say that something is X precisely in the way that it's a potential X. One of the ways that I can do this is I can say, like, are you a piano player? And is there anybody here who's a piano player? Piano player? You're not playing the piano right now. How could you be a piano player? Well, you're a piano player precisely in the way that you have the potential to play piano if the keyboard's good playing. Right? This is one of the ways in which being is articulated. Says Aristotle. Well, in different respects, though, right? Because, yeah, insofar as I have fingers and ears, I suppose everybody's.
It's understood by that. By, you know, are you a piano player? We're understood when you ask that question. You're just asking, do you have within you the knowledge as to how to play the piano that you don't suck?
I feel like I've had this conversation with administrators before who said, like, why don't you teach this philosophy class? And I'll say, like, I have no expertise or training in that material. And they're like, well, you're a philosopher, so you could potentially teach any philosophy class. And I'm like, I could play the violin, potentially. I don't advertise myself as a violinist, though, right? Because we mean potentiality in at least these two distinct senses. Or we also mean actuality in multiple senses. But again, that's all Aristotle and his extraction from.
But it explains so much of this. It's so related to this, though.
And it's not very. Like, part of the issue here is, like, this is a little bit half-baked, but it's because she's first on the scene.
Yeah. She doesn't have the benefit of all the information that we have. So we have to choose.
Aristotle's a towering mind, but he's also standing on the shoulder of some giants. And where Margaret Cavendish is coming into this is like trying to pick up the pieces after Descartes blew the world up. Yeah.
Okay, so, rather impressed with myself. I somehow managed to follow your discussion on Aristotle right there. What I didn't follow was what you brought it up insofar as what it served to bring up Aristotle's view on potentiality. Like, okay, that's Aristotle's view. How is that? What were you asserting as to the relevance of that here?
Can I try?
Yeah, go for it.
Because it would be easier to think about this in terms of matter and form that are always needed together in order to make something exist than it would be to think about this in terms of mind and matter and then deny that mind exists.
Yeah.
We can think of mind as like an abstraction in thought alone. This is how Aristotle lives. He says, like, the soul is the form of the living body as living. But it's that soul is not separable from the body. Only in thought can you do it. It's like the head side of a coin and the tail side of a coin. Right? You can separate them in thought, but they always come together.
Quick clarification. When you're saying form under Aristotle,
what something is.
Yeah.
What assembly what something is.
Take
matter if something
okay.
is.
Okay. What?
You can set these four definitions in physics.
Yes,
take philosophy 251.
Okay. Got it.
All right. Cutting it off.
Moving on.
All right.
So, we get some sense of what's going on here? That she's like wading into a problem and it's not really clear how she's working her way through it, but it seems like what she's articulating is the solution to this seems to be to just reject this substance that Descartes and Cartesians are talking about, this immaterial mind. That can't be a thing. At least as an independently existing substance, and even the Aristotelians would have to be on board with this. They would say, like, yes, you're right. Independently existing non-material substance isn't a thing, except it's God. It's certainly not us. It's not mind. What we get out of thinking about mind or soul or ourselves as material, though, and thinking about it from a naturalistic sort of a perspective, is now this really, really clever thing that maybe, like, Descartes isn't the enemy here. Maybe Descartes actually got this started. This idea that we have now a grounding for perception. Bodily sensory perception was one of these things that Descartes was doubting, by the end of Meditation 6, he seems like, maybe he's trying to at least pretend, if not that he succeeded in bringing some sort of reliability of sensory data back in. A lot of it's really resting very heavily on the idea that God wouldn't deceive him or build him in such a way that, like, he would be deceived. But if ideas are just effects of causes in a physical world, then there's some sort of reliability, right? Ideas don't just come out of nowhere. Just like the chalk doesn't just, like, fly across the room out of nowhere. There's a causal process at work, and if studied, it can be revealed. And if we think of mind in this way, suddenly, like, the way that ideas come to the mind is also predictable. Ideas are also going to be, like, what are ideas? Descartes says, ideas are like a mode of res cogitans. They're the things that thinking things think. And Margaret Cavendish is going to say, like, they're matter, right? This is, like, if you're thinking to yourself, like I'm guessing many of you are thinking to yourself throughout, like, these past several weeks, isn't the mind just the brain? And ideas are just, like, things that the brain does. They're states of the brain. Those states can't exist independent of any matter. They're the software that's got to be written on some sort of hardware, right? Now, that would be one way of thinking about it. Margaret Cavendish takes a slightly different route, interestingly enough. And it's this version where she says, it's kind of a, I might call it a quasi-panpsychism. Quasi-panpsychism. And what I mean by panpsychism is there anybody who does know what I mean by panpsychism? Yeah. Oh, don't know. Anybody who doesn't know? All right. At least one person, so it's worth saying. Do you know or don't know? Okay, good. Panpsychism, if we break it down into its component parts, pan means?
Multi.
Multi, yeah, or all. Yeah, all-encompassing. Pan is all. And psychism? Suke, right? Suke is the Greek word for soul, mind, whatever. Yeah, now we know. Suke is, like, in psychology and psychiatry and all of these other things. Psyche, right? Yeah. So it's just kind of like, basically the idea of panpsychism is everything has a mind. And she doesn't really go quite there, but she gets us right to the doorstep where it's like, we end up maybe saying that, like, way more things than your average Cartesian ever would have supposed have a mind. And the way that she articulates this is she talks about different kinds of matter. And it's not clear what she's getting at here. Like, are these, like, could we very well say, like, different kinds of matter? You mean, like, different sorts of substance, perhaps? Are we going to have more than one substance? We're just getting over having more than one substance. You told us only one, and now we're going to divide it up. But she talks about inanimate matter. And then she talks about animate matter. Probably could have guessed that was the next category, right? And animate matter itself gets broken into two categories. Anybody remember what they are? This one's on the rule is. Sensitive and rational. Yeah. And again, perhaps the Aristotle fans in the room might say to yourselves, like, that looks an awful lot like different kinds of soul that Aristotle talks about. We're just missing the vegetative soul somewhere in here, right? A sensitive soul and a rational soul. Margaret Cavendish is talking about these as different kinds of matter. And in fact, she describes them as, like, getting progressively more fine. She's a bit of an atomist, so, like, all the particles that make up the matter, they're, like, much, much smaller for the animate matter than they are for the inanimate matter, and, like, finer grain for rational matter or sensitive matter, even. And they all get kind of mixed up with one another, such that, like, you yourself are a composite of, like, all three of these kinds of matter. A lot of your body is made up of inanimate matter, and that's why you have to kind of drag it along with you when you move. It doesn't just move itself. Other parts of your body have to make it move. But there's always some kind of animate matter infused in. Now, what exactly this means, it just seems like it means that for animate, it just kind of means it moves itself. Inanimate matter can totally move. It's not, like, motionless, but when it moves, it gets moved by something else, right? ourselves, or matter can move itself and other sorts of matter. Either according to, when we talk about sensitive matter, we're talking about the way that we usually suppose that animals operate, maybe responding to things like fear and desire through the senses. That's a nice little 1-2 punch, fear and desire, because it kind of, like, everything else could plausibly be just like a very subtle subspecies of those two things. Fear, that's the thing that makes you run away from things. Desire makes you run towards things. I've got an attractive force, I've got a repulsive force. Everything else is just a combination of these two things, right? That would be a sensation. Then rational matter would do this other thing that seems to be thinking, right? Just thinking thoughts that have nothing to do with fear and desire. Presupposing that this is the sort of thing that exists. Yes?
I just had a question, like, when she was talking about race and stuff, like, she made, like, the thing about, like, mixing stuff like water and mud or something, and water and dirt, and, like, that was two separate places, or there was one or whatever, and is it the same thing for the different types of matter, like, or does it count as one thing and another place?
Right, yeah, and it's tough to say exactly how she would respond to this sort of question. But I think I would say something like, well, they get mixed together in, like, one body. One body that's a composite of many bodies. And it just depends on how you want to think about it, right? You'll say, like, I am in one place. Insofar as you'll think about yourself as in one place, you're recognizing that your whole body takes up space, though, right? It's not one point in space. Does that make sense? So the mud is all in one place when I mix water and dirt. Does that make sense? Like, where is the mud? It's in the hole. You don't say, the mud is in many places. It's there, and there, and there, and there, and there. Like, no, the mud's just in the hole.
Relative.
When all these things get, what's that?
Relative.
Well, that, yeah, in the hole is an inherently relative sort of idea, right? It's got an inside-outside relationship. Yep.
Okay, so we did explain that we were supposed to reduce everything to matter, and thus we can understand it better. But by defining these different kinds of matter that function in these different ways, isn't she still kind of establishing that therefore they must have different rule sets for their understanding, just as we did before, and kind of like, isn't that defeat the point of calling everything matter you then perceive to be like, and it's different, just like it was different before?
Yeah, I can definitely understand that reservation, because it seemed like one of the moves that got made here when we went from a dualism to basically a materialism, right? What we end up talking about here is, at least for most things, you could say she's a material monist. At least when it comes to the natural world. And I'm not sure if it's in the selected letters that were assigned or in other places. It all kind of bleeds together after all the years. But I know that she frequently said, it was like, if there was such a thing that wasn't matter, it would have to be outside of nature. God ends up being the prime candidate for this form. So yeah, I'm sympathetic. It seems like, well, we simplified things. This at least is like a big part of the Hobbesian argument for why we should be materialists rather than dualists, is to say, we can accomplish all the same things. We can explain the world just as well, and we can do it in half the substances. Simpler is better, right? That's what William Bockham said. Simpler explanation tends to be the better one, so why not adhere to a principle of parsimony? And here, now she explodes it back into, like, many different kinds of matter. Where did our principle of parsimony go? But maybe we're just talking about classifying those types. We'll say they're all the same substance, they just act in different ways. The same way that I might divide all of the matter of the world into, what are we up to now, 120-something elements? That all act in slightly different ways?
Or possibly another metallic hydrogen.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Well, but if it's got one proton, it's not a new element. But yeah, we can divide all the matter up into solid, liquid, and gas. I'm not multiplying entities. I'm just classifying the kinds of the one entity, right? Metals, non-metals. However it is that I want to divide things up. And she says, well, we can do it this way. Sensitive, rational, and inanimate matter, and it all gets mixed together such that we can start to kind of plausibly think of a way of talking about there's nothing that is completely devoid of little sensitive or rational matter particles. You might not have very many of them, so you might not act in a very kind of ostentatiously rational way, but there's some rational matter there, and it's thinking. In the sense that, like, we can start to work our way back. Like, we all believe that humans can think. Descartes showed us that that was kind of undoubtable. I tend to believe him on that. I can think, at least. I did it when he asked me to. What about my dog? Can my dog think? Descartes said no soul. It's just a complicated machine. But what do you think? Does a dog have a mind?
Yes.
Can it think? Where do you draw the line? Does an earthworm have a mind? Does it think? Does it have a subjective perspective on the world?
It doesn't think in the same way, but it thinks.
What about a tree? A tree think? Trees communicate? Do they communicate in a way that they understand or have any kind of... they make any meaning of the communications? Because we might say something like, watch here, my hand's going to communicate with the shock.
Is that communication? If one plant is being hurt, it'll send out a stress signal, and stuff that other plants can perceive and understand.
So just to be clear, we can describe this in terms of just a physical chain of causal reactions, right?
Yes.
You don't necessarily have to have any minds at work there.
The issue is to prove that.
And we might, because if we're going to talk about that way, we might as well also talk about what two rocks in space that are gravitationally attracted to one another. Is that desire? Do they notice one another? Do they think? And one of the things that a panpsychist might say is something like, yeah, they do. Really low-level thinking. This is about as low-level thinking as there could possibly be. You're like, what do rocks think when they're falling? Like, they think, falling! That's all they think. They don't even think, I'm falling. It's just, go! Down! Down, 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 down! That's what a falling rock thinks. It's not very sophisticated thought. It's maybe because there's a little bit of sensitive, because the rock has a desire to be close to the earth. A little sensitive matter mixed in the rock. Everything's got a little bit, because it's all mixed up and that stuff is so fine. It's such these tiny little particles of thinking matter. You've got a lot of them. Socrates had even more. Cavendish is offering, it seems to be in the midst of this stuff, where she says, matter has to think because we think, and we can't be something other than matter. That seems like a pretty tight syllogism, no? I think, I've got to be matter, therefore matter can think.
That doesn't mean that the matter is the reason.
More than all matter.
Oh, yeah. I don't know, are we on the hook for why? Why does matter think?
Or if it's the matter that...
Oh, if it's the matter that thinks, is it some other thing that thinks?
I think that's what they call it.
Because the thing that thinks, that's me, right?
Yeah.
And I thought I said that I have to be matter. Because I have, like, motion and place.
Which part resistance?
And there's causation. Well, I'm really not impressed by the distinction. We've got an interaction problem. We've got this business that, like, it seems obvious that I do have place and motion. And place and motion are things that properly belong to bodies, not immaterial res cogitans. So, like, yeah, why? Why should I suppose res cogitans? I'm just res extensa. I'm a sophisticated, like if Descartes wants to say, like, you know, the lower animals are just sophisticated machines. We can think of Cavendish as responding in like one of two ways. One way she could be like, no, they're not. They clearly like think. They're more than machines. They're kind of like self-moving matter. They're alive, right? Or she might say, like, yeah, okay, living things are just really complicated machines. Guess what? You're one too. And not just your body that like somehow your mind is riding around in, sitting in the cockpit of the pineal gland. your mind is also a very, very sophisticated machine. That is part of nature. Follows natural laws. Nobody's invented that concept just yet, by the way, natural laws. And you can see it, it's coming, right? It's right there. It like behaves in a predictable sort of way. Now, some of the things that are gonna get like seriously wrecked by this approach, by the way, are gonna be things like, okay, hey, what's up with free will, though, by the way? Is it part of nature following like natural laws? Is there gonna be any? Descartes said our will is infinitely free. That was maybe easy to suppose when it was just res cogitans, right? Mm-hmm. Now that it's matter and it's gonna behave in all the ways that like matter does behave. Yeah, if your free will has to obey natural laws, that's...
So then you can't imagine a world without gravity?
Wait, what?
Your free will, but you can, you know, will yourself to imagine a world where gravity doesn't exist. Everything just kind of floats around over
right
there.
And were you completely free to imagine that?
You're not freely willing, you're just willing.
Are you sure you weren't caused by ideas that I expressed as I've been talking over the last hour?
But it follows the natural laws.
Yeah, it follows the natural laws that like are really easy to understand in kind of like the really broad and kind of clumsy aspects of causation, like how it is that I made my vocal cords vibrate, and then with my mouth and my tongue and my teeth made certain noises come out, and then those were propagated through waves across the room to your eardrum through like. Of this kind of, what I imagine now is like a Rube Goldberg machine in your brain. And then eventually a much more complicated version of causation that has yet to be understood that involves you thinking thoughts and then making your own noises. Right? About what was it again? Imagining a world without gravity. Yeah. All part of a causal process, right? There's a whole lot more to be said about this, but we're gonna move on. John Locke. Holy shit, John Locke. This guy's boss. I'll be posting the reading as soon as I get back in my office and a new quiz. I'll see you guys on Tuesday. Talk about John Locke.